Good evening. And good morning to those of you watching at home or online or at the nursing home. We welcome you also in the Lord's name. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. A few announcements before we get started. As we have done in the past, we are hosting a trunk or treat event in our church parking lot on October 31st. There's information in your bulletins about that if you want to help. Now, I know that there are some concerns that people have about hosting something like that in times like this, but I take solace in knowing that no one's forced to be here, that coming to church is a risk, and it's a risk that you're willing to take in order to be here, and that I'm willing to take to be here. So if people are willing to take any kind of risk like that, we certainly want to continue to serve our neighbors and not only share candy with them, but also the delight of seeing all of these decorated trunks, but also the Word of God, because we do also share those in different ways with the people that pass on by. So I don't know what else to say about that other than we're still going to plan on having it. So anyway, if you have concerns about that, you're certainly welcome to share those with me. But as long as we're having church and it's a free thing that people can come or not come to, depending on their comfort level, we're going to plan on having it. There's a youth gathering type of conference coming up next summer. So if you know somebody who is in the youth group age that might be interested in going to something like that, please let me know. There's sort of a trade-off. It's a lot cheaper than the youth gathering, and it's not in place of the youth gathering, by the way. It's just the youth gathering itself, the National Youth Gathering, is 2 years away. This is next summer, and it's a shorter time period. The trade-off is that it's a lot cheaper. It's only $400, but we're not going to have national acts like Toby Mac performing at this conference either. So there's kind of the trade-off. But if you know somebody who's a teenager that might be interested in going away for a few days to Fort Collins, Colorado, and seeing some scenery and really being immersed in the Word of God, please let them know that there is an opportunity for that next summer, and they should let me know. You can also go online. Our church's webpage has a link under the Sunday School and Youth section where you can find out more information about that. Reminder to our church leaders, we do have our monthly meeting tomorrow, not tomorrow night, but it'd be tomorrow night if you're watching this on Sunday, next Monday night for our council meeting and elders meeting. The Appleton Zone of the LWML has a fall workshop on joy that's coming up, being hosted at Trinity Lutheran Church in Ortonville. There's some more information in the bulletin about that as well, so if that's something that would interest you, ladies, you can certainly check that out. Since today is our celebration of LWML Sunday, which is Wednesday, but we're still celebrating our LWML and recognizing them tonight, I have asked Mary to say a few words about the ministry of LWML.
Just going to start with a couple things off the LWML website. For over 77 years, the LWML has focused on affirming each woman's relationship with Christ, encouraging and equipping women to live out their Christian lives in active mission ministries and to support global missions. The object of the LWML is mission education, mission inspiration, mission service, and financial grants for mission needs. So obviously the main focus of LWML is mission. The motto for LWML is serve the Lord with gladness. Here at St. Mark's, our LWML society is our women's guild, and we serve people through our various committees, and we serve people within the church and within the community and then beyond that. And our committees are Keeping in Touch and Altar Guild and Soup and Pie and our sewers who make the quilts and Meals on Wheels committee and other ones. So that's how we're able to serve through those committees. In November, we'll be putting our sign-up sheets out there for the next 2 years for our committees. So I just want to encourage our ladies to sign up for those committees and see that as an opportunity of how you can serve. And I also want to thank you for the mites you give when we collect them after worship services back here. Those mites go to missions. So when you give to that collection, you are serving and helping others. 25% of the mites that we send in go to national mission grant projects, and then the other 75% goes to our Minnesota North District mission grants. And this biennium, Minnesota North is giving to Orphan Grain Train, Lutheran Island Camp and Christ Church Branch, Mission Central, Christ Care for Children in Kenya, scholarships for men preparing for ordination, as well as scholarships for full-time church work students. There's also a grant helping orphans and elderly in Haiti, as well as other mission grants. The mite box offerings and mite door offerings that we collect and that, you know, all churches and everybody all over the world have funded over $100 million in mission grants since the organization's beginning in 1942. So that shows that every penny really does count. Last, I just want to invite all of our women to join us for our monthly meetings, the third Tuesday of each month, 7 o'clock. And each meeting includes a Bible study, usually led by a pastor, and a business meeting, and then fellowship also. So I just encourage everybody to join us for that. And then the ladies, if you haven't already grabbed a pen and a brochure out there, go ahead and do so this evening.
Great, thank you. And thank you to all the ladies who serve with our LWML. God does amazing and wonderful things through you, and we are grateful for that. Our order of service is the order of service, Divine Service 1. Everything's printed out for you in the bulletins, as always. Our opening hymn is From All That Dwell Below the Skies. May God bless our worship. Of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The intro for today is taken from Psalm 84. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts! My soul longs, yes, faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and flesh sing for joy to the living God. Even the sparrow finds a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young at your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Blessed are those who dwell in your house, ever singing your praise. For a day in your courts is better than a thousand elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, blessed is the one who trusts in you. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. We continue now with the Kyrie. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Let us pray. O God, the strength of all who put their trust in you, mercifully accept our prayers, and because, due to our mortal nature, we are unable to do any good thing without your aid, grant us the help of your grace, that keeping your commandments, we may please you in both will and deed. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated. The Old Testament reading for today is taken from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 25. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow, of aged wine well refined. And he will swallow up on this mountain the covering that is cast over all peoples, the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. And the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces. Then the reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, behold, this is our God. We have waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The epistle reading for today comes from Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at length you have revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am in to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. In preparation for the reading of the gospel, we rise now and sing the Alleluia and verse. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 22nd chapter. And again, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son, and sent his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding feast, but they would not come. Again, he sent other servants, saying, 'Tell those who are invited, see, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized the servants, treated them shamefully, and killed them. The king was angry, and he sent his troops and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding feast is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore to the main roads and invite to the wedding feast as many as you find.' And those servants went out into the roads and gathered all whom they found, both bad and good. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to look at the guests, he saw there was a man who had no wedding garment. And he said to him, "Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment?" And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, "Bind him hand and foot and cast him into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are called, but few are chosen." This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated as we continue now with the sermon hymn, "How Can I Thank You, Lord?" Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. If you were here last week, you may remember that I talked about how when the readings for each Sunday were first compiled, it was the intention of those compiling the readings that the Old Testament reading and the Gospel reading would fit together, that there'd be some kind of connection. Today I want to tell you another aspect of how these readings were put together, and it's the fact that when the readings were put together, they were put on a what's called a three-year lectionary. What that means is that there's a three-year cycle for the readings. So the readings that you heard read earlier tonight will come up again 3 years from now and 6 years from now and so on. Now, the reason I want you to understand that is so that you'll have some idea of what I was thinking 6 years ago as I was preparing to preach on these same exact texts. The week leading up to that Sunday, which now it is the 19th Sunday in Pentecost, was an extraordinary week. The previous Sunday, we had announced to the congregation that Tracy was pregnant and that soon little Zeb was going to have a little sister. As you can imagine, the congregation was happy for us and they rejoiced with us. But by the time next Sunday rolled around, our joy had turned to grief. On Thursday, Tracy went into her scheduled doctor's appointment and received the bad news that our little Katerina had died. Like millions of other women and other families who had lost a child to miscarriage, we were understandably devastated by that news. But as devastated as I was, I still had a sermon to write. And these were the texts that I had to work with. At that time, I didn't know what to think, much less what to say. So I prayed about it, and then I cried, and then I prayed some more. But I still didn't know what to say or how I should say it. Because how could I preach some good news when I had just heard the worst news that any parent can hear? Anyone who's ever lost a child at any age can understand that pain. It's a tragedy that often defies the words to describe it. Perhaps that's why, in the end, I did something on that Sunday that I rarely ever do. I preached without any kind of written manuscript. That's because I wasn't sure what I was going to say or how I was going to say it. I was trusting in the Spirit to guide me. But I knew that there was one message I wanted to preach. And that one message was something I wanted to preach because it's what I and my family needed to hear. We desperately needed to hear it back then. And in fact, we still do. And so do you. Even if you aren't currently experiencing any kind of pain or grief, you need to hear it. Because we all need to hear it and to be reminded of this simple truth. God is good. No matter what is going on in our lives. And God is good. In times of pain and struggle and hardships, sometimes it's hard for us to remember that. We think that those things, including even death, are somehow His fault or His will. They aren't. He never wanted any of those things for us. He wanted us to live forever in that perfect paradise that He created for us. A place where there wasn't any pain or sorrow or death. But when our first parents sinned, their rebellion corrupted everything beautiful and good that God had made. And their sin has now become my sin and your sin. And it continues to cast a dark pall over every aspect of our lives. Now we are compelled by that sinful nature that resides in us to follow the example of our first parents and sin against God and one another. It's we, not God, who have brought the shadows of darkness into God's light and love-filled creation. But the darkness that's in us and the evil that's in the world cannot change the fact that God Himself is good. He's still the light of the world who gives life to everyone who believes. As the prophet Isaiah proclaimed about the victory that Christ would someday win, the covering that is cast over all peoples, the veil of death that is spread over all the nations, has been swallowed up by God and destroyed on Mount Zion. Zion is that place on earth where God and man dwell together in his perfect peace. In the Old Testament, Zion was often a reference to Mount Sinai, where Moses dwelt with God there in the light and glory of God's presence. But the actual physical location of Zion was actually the temple in Jerusalem. That's where God's people came to him and dwelt with him and received from him forgiveness and life. But of course, all of that Old Testament Zion stuff was just foreshadowing of the true Zion to come, which was our Lord Jesus Christ. In him alone, God and man are united as one and live together forever in his perfect peace and harmony. So many people in our world think that peace and joy can be found in worldly things, and that their cause for rejoicing is based on things that they can see or hear or taste or touch or hold. They look for Zion in those places, that in the things that make their lives comfortable or easy. And that's why they struggle to find that joy and that peace. 6 years ago, I was struggling to find that joy and that peace. But eventually I did find it. And it was in the same place where it's always been, in the cross of Jesus Christ. He's our source for true joy and lasting peace. He gives hope to the hopeless, light to those trapped in darkness, and life to those who are dead. Sometimes we forget that because we can't see it with our eyes, and our human minds can't comprehend how it's possible to be joyful in the midst of such tragedy and pain. But it's in those times that it's helpful to remember that God's work is not dependent on our ability to see it or understand it. And that's especially helpful to remember by those parents whose children have died before they were ever born. Although there are no specific promises in Scripture that guarantee that those children automatically go to heaven, for Christian parents, there are reasons for hope. Our biggest source of hope comes from baptism. Now, that might sound weird, since those children never received that sacrament, but baptism is a powerful reminder to us that forgiveness, life, and salvation are God's works, not ours. That's why we baptize infants, because babies can receive gifts, even if they don't know they're receiving them. And those gifts belong to them just as surely as they could belong to anyone else, because it's not dependent on them or on us, but on the promises that God has fulfilled for us through Jesus Christ. When babies are baptized, they don't know what God has done for them, but we do, because God told us in his word that he makes them his beloved children and holy saints, and it's not because of their works. It's by the word that they've heard and believed by the power of the Holy Spirit. When our little girl died, we knew that she had heard God's word because we were in church every Sunday and because she heard it read in our home. And I believe that God did work through that word to give her faith and ultimately eternal life. In addition to that, I know that even before we're born, God has already seen our unformed bodies. He knitted us together. And even then, he knows us and loves us. So if John the Baptist can be led by the Spirit to leap in his mother's womb before he was born, just because the Savior was approaching, I'm sure that that same Spirit can work faith in an unborn child and give to her his promised gifts. After all, if a child can hear and respond to her mother's voice, how much more can they hear and believe the voice of their Heavenly Father? God is good because he loved her more than I ever could. And I believe that he loves her still because she's now alive again and with him. He swallowed up her death and gave her life. In difficult times, it's tempting to blame God and to consider him the enemy. But God isn't the enemy. He's the Savior. He doesn't will death, although he does allow it. But his promise remains that whoever believes in him, even though they die, yet they shall live. That's what God does. He works good in all things for those who love him. Now, there are critics of Christianity who call our faith in that promise a crutch, a delusion that we've constructed to comfort ourselves in troubled times. But the real delusion is thinking that you can make it through this world and out of this world into the next one without Christ. Sin is indeed a vicious enemy, and death is an unstoppable foe. But thanks be to God that death never has the last word. The last word always belongs to God. And through that word, he welcomes rebellious sinners home, and he strengthens those who have no strength left. And last and best of all, he gives life to those who are dead. My confidence in those promises is found in the short little phrase that Isaiah uttered in tonight's Old Testament reading, when he spoke to give confidence to God's people that God would do what he promised to do. They could believe all that God said he would do, quote, "For the Lord has spoken." The Lord has spoken. And that's all that we need to know, because we know that he is Almighty God, and he can do and always does what he says he will do. For us, the Lord has spoken. He has spoken forgiveness, mercy, tenderness, compassion, and life. Even the hope of eternal life is already ours, because that's what God promised to do. The Lord has spoken. That's where our true hope resides, in the word of the Lord, because he keeps his word, and he works through it to do amazing and even impossible things for us. God is good because he turns our losses into his victories. When death thinks that it's found its next victim, he snatches his saints out of the grave, he lifts them up in his loving arms, and he sets them at his heavenly banquet table. God is good. I know that he loves me despite all my sins and weaknesses and failures, and I promise you he feels the same way about you. That's why he's good, because he is merciful and kind. God is good because he is patient and gracious. He's good because he makes wonderful promises to us, and then he keeps every last one of them. And because he has, my dear friends in Christ, we can rejoice in the Lord's salvation always. Again and forever, I will say it, rejoice. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all our human understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. In honor and recognition of the ladies who serve God's church and our church, I would like to invite the ladies of our LWML to stand and recite the pledge with me. In fervent gratitude for the Savior's dying love and his blood-bought gift of redemption, we dedicate ourselves to him with all that we are and have. And in obedience to his call for workers in the harvest fields, we pledge him our willing service wherever and whenever he has need of us. We consecrate to our Savior our hands to work for him, our feet to go on his errands, our voices to sing his praises, our lips to proclaim his redeeming love, our silver and our gold to extend his kingdom, our will to do his will, and every power of our life to the great task of bringing the lost and the erring into eternal fellowship with him. Amen. At this time, I invite the rest of the congregation to rise as we confess the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. We continue now with the prayers of the church. Gracious Heavenly Father, grant us your Holy Spirit, that we may continually rejoice in your salvation as we remember the loving kindness and mercy that you've generously lavished upon us. As we thank you for all the spiritual and physical blessings that you've given us, may our lives reflect the profound gratitude that we have towards you and for all that you have done, so that you may be glorified in all that we say and do. O Lord, because we believe your word, we trust your promises to grant help and healing to those who cry out to you in their times of trouble. Therefore, we ask you to be merciful and kind to those in need, especially Beth, Elizabeth, Ruth, Belwyn, Amy, Michelle, Stephen, Trevor, Rebecca, Rosemary, Heather, Madeline, Tom, Giselle, Linda, Jim, Lydia, Roger, Lynn, Chuck, Shirley, Peggy, Ken, Kellen, Paul, Mark, Sharon, and Kirsten. Holy Spirit, we give you thanks for adopting Oakley Stauffacher and all of us into your family through the waters of baptism and bestowing on us your promised gifts of grace. We especially rejoice with those others who celebrate their baptismal birthdays this week, including Michaela, Gary, Sharon, Savannah, Madison, Brady, Tracy, Caitlin, and Nicole. May they live and rejoice in all the gifts that you've given them at the baptismal font. Almighty God, you rule the whole universe and everything in it is under your loving care. Therefore, we ask you to protect all those who are at risk of contracting the virus, those who are now unemployed or underemployed, those who have been harmed by violent protests, those who suffer from heavy burdens imposed on them by the sins of others, those in prison or orphanages, and those who rely on the weather for their livelihood. May you work good in all things and give to your people those things that you know they need. Thank you, Lord, for the mission of the Lutheran Women's Mission League, as they assist each woman of our church in affirming the relationships they have with you, so that they may be enabled to use their gifts to support the work of the church through the gathering of mites, mission grants, and Bible studies and fellowship opportunities that strengthen the bonds between themselves and you. May you continue to shine the light of your blessings upon them and uphold them with your gracious love. Finally, Lord, we ask you to bless, guide, and keep the leaders of your church on earth, including Matt, our synodical president, Don, our district president, Don, our circuit visitor, and all the leaders of St. Mark's who serve us in a variety of ways. May your spirit rest upon them and work through them so that they may be enabled to continue faithfully serving this congregation. All of these things and whatever else may be on our hearts and minds this day, we lift all of it up to you in the name of Jesus. Amen. We continue with the service of the sacrament. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who overcame death in the grave and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. Remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." And in the same way also after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And the peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us now stand and join together in singing the post-communion canticle. Let us pray. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, you have given us a foretaste of the feast to come in the Holy Supper of your Son's body and blood. Keep us firm in the true faith throughout our days of pilgrimage, that on the day of his coming, we may, together with all your saints, celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give to you his peace. You may be seated for the singing of our closing hymn.